All right, how's everybody doing? Doing good? Please continue eating if you haven't finished already, but we're gonna get started here. I have the distinct privilege of introducing Yeonmi Park. Let's hear it. Born in North Korea, human rights activist and YAF speaker, Yeonmi Park grew up in a punishing society devoted to the worship of Kim Jong-il. At the age of 13, she and her family made a daring escape to China in search of a life free from tyranny. In her viral talks, viewed online hundreds of millions of times, Park urges audiences to recognize and resist the oppression that exists in North Korea and around the world. Growing up in North Korea, it was normal for Park to see dead bodies as she was walking to school, and to be so hungry that she ate wild plants. After watching pirated copies of American movies, the veil of tyranny began to fall. Having caught a glimpse of a free world, Park realized that her experience of life wasn't the only one, and that she might one day find a way out. In 2002, Park's father was arrested and sent to a prison camp for engaging in, quote, illegal trading, selling materials that no one would be punished for in a free society. In 2009, Park and her mother crossed the Gobi Desert to Mongolia from China in negative 40 degree weather, finding their freedom in South Korea. She recounts this incredible journey in her memoir, In Order to Live, A North Korean Girl's Journey to Freedom, and in the moving talks based on her experiences. An insightful and candid speaker, Park is fast becoming a leading voice of oppressed people around the world. The BBC named Park one of their top 100 global women, and she has quickly become one of YAF's most requested speakers on college campuses around the country. Park is also the author of While Time Remains, A North Korean Defector's Search for Freedom in America, which was published earlier this year, and which you all will receive a free copy of today. So, without further ado, please join me in welcoming the one and only Yeonmi Park.
Good afternoon, everyone. So today, before I got here, I did this book signing at the reception, and I met this amazing, amazing people. And while I was doing my book signing, this thought came to me, because when I was in North Korea, I believed that Americans were cold-blooded reptiles, because that's what my teacher taught me. And then I was like, these people are not monsters. They are the warmest people in the world. And I was thinking, wow, there's really no limit what lie governments can create to control people. And then I was thinking, how is it that different? Now in America, we are forced to believe that men can give birth. There's no difference between men and women. It's not that different than forcing us to believe that Americans are cold-blooded reptiles in North Korea. And this is why I'm standing here. A lot of people learn about communism, Marxism, socialism, equity, all these concepts in their textbooks, especially in their nice air-conditioned room. And these professors who teach us these amazing theories, who never live them in real life. And in a way, North Korea is a perfect example to remind humanity those idealists, those ideas disguised in the name of compassion and care and justice is actually a tool for the tyrants to oppress people. When I was born in North Korea, I've never seen a map of the world. I did not even know that I was Asian. They taught me that I was Kim Il-sung's race, my dear reader's race. North Korean calendar begins when Kim Il-sung was born. We have a different time zone. We are a different planet. And especially, this is so shocking because Kim Il-sung came to North Korean people in the 1940s. He promised a paradise for us. He said, look, there's a capitalist. There are landlords and there are peasants. This is injustice. There's inequality. If you give me a power, I'm going to create equity. I'm going to create equality of outcomes. I'm going to give you free healthcare. I'm gonna give you free education. I'm gonna give you free housing and free food. If I'm gonna give you all these things for free and take care of you, you need to give up your private property. You have to give up your freedom of speech. You have to give up your freedom of movement. And you know what my grandmother and my grandfather did? They did. They believed them. They thought injustice, the inequality was evil. They gave all these things to Kim Il-sung. And when he took them, all from the North Korean people, as you know, they did not give us anything back. They took the entire thing. I was abducted at birth. It's hard to be abducted before even you were born, right? And that's what North Korean regime does. Before I was born in my mother's tummy, they decided what my life was gonna be, depending on what my grandparents did. So it's depending on what my ancestor did. So in the name of creating this socialist paradise, Kim Il-sung came to North Korea and divided North Korean people into different 51 classes. And you know what? North Koreans are homogeneous people. We speak the same language. We were the same people for 5,000 years until Kim Il-sung. And now we have 51 different caste system. In big these categories, they divide us into three big groups. And often we compare them to fruits. So number one class is a royal. You're royal to the regime. They say you are tomato. You're red inside, you are red outside. Therefore, you are a complete believer of communism. No doubt you believe in this ideology. Second, middle class is called wavering. You're apple. You're red outside, but you're red you're white inside. So you're questionable. They need to surveillance you if you are gonna change your color or not. The third class, the bottom third, you are screwed. You're grape. You're not even red inside. You're not even red outside. Therefore, you're hostile. They have to oppress you since your birth. But this, your caste system, is determined from your ancestors, what they have done during the revolution. And I see this happening in America right now. I have a son who is half white and who's half Asian. They say that he's privileged because he's white, because maybe his ancestors at some point might have owned the slaves. So now he needs to answer to their crime. It's something called collective guilt, guilt by association. That is why the very first thing my mom taught me as a young girl in North Korea was, don't even whisper, because the birds and mice could hear me. If I said one wrong thing in North Korea, it was going to kill up to 3 to 8 generations of my family from my mother and my father's side. And that's what communists do. They get rid of the seed of a rebellion. By the time when I was 13 years old, it was 2007, I couldn't find any more food in North Korea. And this is a weird reason that people don't understand. Why do North Koreans starve? We are not some Haiti or Africa, there's natural disasters happening. We are starving because Kim Jong-il thought it's easier to control people when they are starving. Because all day long, we are going to worry about looking for next meal, surviving one more day. And we are not going to think about the meaning of life and freedom. That's why he decided not to feed North Korean people. And in the 90s, when North Korean people were dying, millions from mass starvation, when I was a toddler, people asked him, like, dear leader, the people are dying from starvation. What shall we do? Do you know what he said? It's easy to do socialism when there are less people. So let them die. As long as we keep the 10% in Pyongyang and capital alive, until the 90% of them die off, we are not gonna do anything. It's actually a good thing for us. In America, I heard this same thing at Columbia. I heard professors saying that humans are disease. We are a poison to the Mother Earth. And it's so good thing that we try to have less people, because it's less easy to control people when there are less of them. So I had to escape from my homeland to find food. And the price was for me to looking for a bowl of rice was crossing the frozen Yalu River, risking my life. I crossed the frozen river with my mother at 13. And then first thing I saw when I got to the China side was my mother being raped. And then the Chinese traffickers told us the only reason, the only way for us to be fed and be alive in China was us being sold as sex toys. I know it's a lot of you are minors, but I was 13, so I don't think we need a safe space here, right? Trigger warnings. Being raped in China as a North Korean woman is not the worst thing can happen to you, because there are three places right now in the 21st century under CCP that buys North Korean women. Number one place that buy North Korean women are the organ harvesters. They buy North Korean girls, and they take our organs out and discard our body. Number two place they buy us is a brothels. They put us in a room, there are no windows, and give us drugs and rape us 500 times a day, and we don't last more than 6 months. The last place we end up is so-called husband, the men who buy us, and sometimes entire village chip in and buy one girl and get gang rape her. My mother was sold for $65 in the 21st century. And then they sold me over $200 because I was 13 years old, child virgin. And some perverted men in China, they love child virginity. So they give more money to buy us. 2 years of my slavery, I met Christian missionaries from South Korea. And they were rescuing us. And these missionaries came to me saying that there was a way out. There's a way to be free. And you know, when you're in North Korea, we don't even know the word free. There is no word for love. There's no concept of human rights. And this also very close to linking to the control of language. Why the left is so obsessed controlling the word is because if you don't know the word, that means you don't understand the concept. So by removing the word human rights, free, love, North Korean people are not gonna understand what that is. So me hearing that word free, I was asking this person, what do you mean that I'm gonna be free in South Korea? And how would you explain freedom to North Korean person? Are you gonna tell them it's a freedom of religion, freedom of of speech? They're not gonna understand that. And this person gave me the perfect thing to make me understand. They said, sweetie, if you go to South Korea, you can wear jeans and you can watch K-dramas. And nobody's going to arrest you for that. Because that is the same thing, exact things that North Korean people right now go to jail and get executed for. Just few weeks ago, the regime sent a two-year-old to a concentration camp in North Korea because that parent owned the Bible. And for me, hearing that there is a land where I can go, decide what pants I can wear, decide what haircut I can get, decide what movie I can watch, I thought that was a paradise. So I decided to escape one more time. And this time, it wasn't just crossing frozen Yalu River. It was crossing the frozen Gobi Fast desert into Mongolia, walking from China. By then I was 15 years old. It was 2009. And I wanted to live life with dignity. So I tried a lot. The percent of surviving the desert was 1%. So that's why right now, over the 80 years, only 209 North Korean defectors made it to America. With some miracle, I survived the desert, and I was sent to South Korea. I came to America in 2015, and started to study at Columbia University in 2016. I came to this country with a great hope, because there are right now 5 billion human beings living under tyranny. And this country is a beacon of hope. This is a land of opportunity. And then when I got to Columbia, I was speechless, because the professors at Columbia University were teaching exact same things that my North Korean teachers taught us in the classroom. They say America is evil. It's irredeemable. The only solution for us to solve all these problems is by destroying the Constitution and the Western civilization. They even went further to saying that math is a racist. Math is made up to control minority people. And I remembered my first lesson I got from my North Korean classroom. My teacher asked me one day in North Korea, what's 1 + 1? What is 1 + 1? 2. My teacher said, you're wrong, Yeonmi. 1 + 1 is, my dear little discovered, if you add one drop of water to another drop of water, what does it become? It becomes bigger one. It does not become 2. That's how he proved that math was made up by white men to control the minority. The tactics are the same. What American mainstream institutions are doing is the same. Yesterday, a hit piece came out on New York Times against me, saying that I'm a professional victim. And I was like, I literally began my book in 2014 saying that there are two things I'm grateful for. That one was I was born in North Korea, and one was that I escaped. I am actually grateful that I was born in the darkness, because now I can appreciate this light. I know what a miracle to be in a country where people think that humans have rights. When I heard the word animals' rights, I was pissed off. Like, are you kidding me? You think that animals have rights? Why are there billions of people don't even know they have rights as human beings? And this is a country we are in. Their problem is not having a problem. So they have to create keep problems for themselves. They're creating thousands of different pronouns. And if we don't understand them, that's their oppression. That's how they make up their oppression out of thin air. While there are 300,000 North Korean women right now in China going through what I just described to you, they are sold for less than 100 bucks. During the pandemic, in Chinese big websites, it's like American Google, Baidu, they could order North Korean girls like Uber Eats. If you feel like ordering a slave, and raping her and killing her, you can click a few buttons and order the North Korean women in China. And I've been trying to say this to the world, wake up the humanity. There is a Holocaust happening against North Korean people under CCP. And all the people that I met, Hillary Clinton, Jeff Bezos, all American people, they say they care about slavery. When I met them in person, they say, don't tell people that I know you, because they want to make money with the CCP. So I'm very grateful for YAF giving me this platform to be the voice for the voiceless. And I hope you all remember that. People keep asking me that I'm a human rights activist. They come to me, you know, why do I have to care about human rights? Nobody says, why do you have to care about puppies, right? But when it comes to human rights, they ask, why? Why do I have to care about it? Because we are the only ones can fight for human rights. Do you think the puppies are fight for our rights? The robots gonna fight for human rights? And I do wonder, if we become like North Korea one day, that's gonna be a dark world, because when nobody is free, no one can fight for us. And that's why it's our responsibility as free people to fight for the people who does not have freedom and who does not have voice. So thank you everyone for your care and having me here again. Thank you. Thank you so much. so much. We have a Q&A. Thank you. Thank you. We have a Q&A, so thank you so much for that. We have a lot of, I will do Q&A now. Yes.
Yes, thank you so much for those very powerful words. We do have time for Q&A. Students, we will have you line up over where Katie is, and our supporters, if you have a question, please raise your hand, and I will come to you. So we'll start out with a student.
Hello, Ms. Park. Hello. I'm Kenna Fisher. I'm a homeschooler from Southern California. I wanted to first thank you so much for being so vulnerable. I read your book earlier this year for the first time, and it moved me so incredibly so. It taught me what true gratitude is and that I have this freedom. Could you please explain to me what I can do to help the plight of the North Korean people? Because I can't just stand by and watch it happen.
Yeah, thank you for that support. You know, how to help North Korea? The key is in China. The North Korea exists because Chinese regime exists, CCP exists. And to me, right now, America is the only country can compete with China, can keep them accountable. So actually, us keeping America free is a favor to the humanity. Because as long as there's a one free country stance, it's always a threat to a tyranny. Because what dictators want, like Xi Jinping and North Korea, they want that totalitarianism to be the norm. And that's why they hate free countries. That's why they hate America. So us keeping America free, I think this is the best thing you can do ever for the humanity. Thank you. Yeah. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Hannah Joyal, and I'm from Orange County, California. Thank you so much for your talk. It was so inspiring.
Thank you.
I've had friends at school who will talk about how they don't like America or how they'll make jokes about it or even just not appreciating the American flag or wanting to stand up for the for like the Pledge of Allegiance. And how would you respond to that and be able to show them that America is a lot better than what other people are going through?
Yeah, well, my first instinct is always like, go to North Korea, you know? If you hate America so much, the door is open. It's not like North Korea killing people to try to escape. The door is open. We always can leave the country. I think we have to, in a way, expose their hypocrisy. All those people said, if Trump gets elected, they're gonna immigrate to Canada. None of them have left, right? And I think this is the thing, like, we have to show them how they're just, in a way, this is the thing, in a way, it's like even in living in New York and Chicago, it's a cool to trash America, because that's a culture that we are living in. And I think this is where it comes from, us to letting them know, keep giving them a different perspective. And in we, they are still, there is a hope. Everybody deserves a second chance. So I think we have to do our best telling them, having a conversation with them, giving them the books, and bring them to YAF, you know, the conferences, and let them hear a counter perspective. And even after that, they don't change, then they really have to leave. So, but until then, we have to try our best to show them, expose them to counter arguments as much as we can.
Thank you.
Hi, Mrs. Park. Thank you so much for your story.
Thank you.
I'm Joseph Johnston. I'm a rising junior from Orange County. And I just wanted to know, what's the current situation in North Korea like, or like has you speaking out done anything to affect that over there?
Yeah, actually, 6 days ago, BBC had its reporting. So North Korean regime used the pandemic as a perfect excuse to control even people more than before. So with they importing this technology from China, surveillance technology, so they put this a heat detection in the border, face recognition. So if anybody crosses the border, they can find heat detection. So it's a double fencing entire border is shared by two walls and then electrified wire fence, North Korean side and then China side. So what's happening now in North Korea is they are stuck there to waiting to die. All of them are waiting to die. And in North Korea, suicide is not allowed. If somebody commits a suicide, they're gonna go around and punish the family members. That's how they prevent people from committing suicide. And despite that, now there's a mass suicide happening in North Korea because there's no way out, and they know that there's nobody can come there, help them. So it's getting way, way worse than ever before. Thank you.
Hi, Ms. Park. My name is Joseph Grijalva. I'm from Santa Clarita, California. And I was wondering, what step do you think it will be too late to turn back once we reach that point in America?
I think, to me, what I try to focus on every day is being optimistic or being pessimistic is like irrelevant. Because we know that the right thing is fighting for our freedom. So I try to now focusing on when is it gonna be too late. The only thing I do when I'm hopeful is because at least in America, so far now, at least half the country understands that there is a threat is emerging. And to me, what the dangers of this Marxism, especially the wokeism in Colombia, is that they hide these agendas. They hide the word tolerance. It's not tolerant at all. It's almost authoritarianism in Colombia. They say it's a safe space. It's not a safe space at all. If you question their doctrine, you're going to get like kicked out of class or kicked out of university. I think that's why it's getting harder for us to know the truth. And this is a price you pay to be living in dictatorships. They are keep hiding the truth in every kind of twist, and then words doesn't mean the same thing. Like, have you guys read Animal Farm or 1984 by George Orwell? It's literally, you know, freedom is slavery. It's like that. Tolerance is intolerance. They hijack the word. And I think as long as we keep fighting back and we understand what the word of the meaning holds, I think then we understand what each other is saying, and now, because they keep diluting the meaning of language, it keep getting confusing. So I think the war with the language, we have to keep pushing back. Yeah, thank you.
Hi, Mrs. Park, my name is Emiliana Duffy. I'm a homeschooler from Southern California. And I was wondering how we can stop America from becoming a country like North Korea.
Thank you so much. I'm a mother myself. Well, the American youth have to get off from social media, especially TikTok. Thank you. Thank you so much. And well, don't read anything that is New York Times bestseller list. Even that is a lie. Thank you. I think we need to go back to the class books, that the books that American founding fathers wrote and read. Those original work of enlightenment of the Western democracy. I think if we go back to the founding principles, we know that worked. That created the most tolerant country in the face of humanity. And I think if we go back to that, I think we can find our way back out of this chaos. And if the answer is not gonna be right now coming out of just right now somebody just made up in a college campus. It was already there in our founding document. And to me is one last thing I wanna say, like we should never ever give up our guns. Because if we lose that, thank you. Yes. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Nathan Thomas. I'm from Blythe, California. I'm homeschooled. And I was wondering, I've heard a little bit from both the left and right of these claims and whispers about your story mm-hmm. not holding up. Mm-hmm. And I was wondering how you respond to the people who are questioning you and claiming that you're not actually a defector from North Korea, or all these people who say that your story is not true.
Yeah, that's funny, because there is a North Korean state television that published my birth certificate. So it is interesting, right? Like, then did I come from a different planet? Am I an alien? I think those are too silly for me to engage in for that kind of grounds. But there are some grounds that is credible, is especially the part before I wrote my first book in 2014. I did lie about the fact that I was a sex slave for 2 years of my life, from 13 to 15. I was living in South Korea at the time, and I always wanted to be a mother, and I wanted to marry, but there are a lot of cultures, unlike America, that punish the rape victim instead of the perpetrator. And if I ever disclosed my past in South Korea, no same man would marry me and take me as a wife. And when I wrote my first book, I did understand if I did not put my full truth, my story would not have meaning. So that was credible. But after that, all the accusation that I'm getting, that I'm a CIA spy, it's like, when is CIA calling me, really? I literally was canceled by FBI last year. They invited me to speak, and then 2 days before my event, the head of diversity from FBI calls me. Because of your political opinions, we cannot have you as a speaker. That is not an American thing. So that's, they need to get sued. I don't know how to sue FBI, but we need to figure that out. So now they say, you know, she cannot be possibly saying it, because I remember I came to America at 20. I met somebody, and they were like, what do you like to do? I said, I like to read. And what are you reading? I was reading Bastia's The Law, and I was reading On Liberty by John Stuart Mill. And they were like, do you think that people need to have guns? Like, yes. Then that person said, I agree you do, but never ever tell people that. So there, I had to be protected by the liberals for first 5 years of my activism. And then I saw what happened during the BLM. I was living in Chicago. I was robbed one day violently by a few African-American women. And when I was being punched and robbed, I was trying to call the police. The people on the street, instead of helping me, they were calling me a racist. That I was trying to call the cops on the criminals. And that's when I thought, this is the madness of crowd. America has lost their mind. And I came out of my conservative closet. And that has been the hardest class I've ever came out of. So, thank you so much. Yeah.
Hello, Mrs. Park. Thank you so much for your talk. I'm Michael Well from Southern California. And you talked about, in response to the first question, about how we need to focus on the CCP in China to help North Korea. So what specifically can America do, or leaders do, to fight back against the CCP and hopefully take it down at some point?
I think the first thing is us getting a strong leader in the office. Thank you. I think that's like number one urgent thing for us to do as American people. And also, of course, we have to elect our representatives, our government officials who understand that the evilness of China, the threat of China that is posing to all of us. And after that, that is passing, then we all have to denounce these organizations like Hollywood that get funded by CCP, mass producing this propaganda against American people. So when my first book was trying to become a movie in Hollywood, and the Hollywood producer sent me a script, and the script is said that China was my promised land. I was protected, and they gave me a refugee in China under CCP. That is a lie, how far they would go to appease China. The entire Hollywood is a propaganda machine now against American people. And our academia, our mainstream media became that. So us to realizing and pushing back and keep supporting these organizations like YAF or other organizations that fighting against this evil, I think that will be our first responsibility right here. Yeah. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Sarah. I'm from Buchanan High School. And my question for you is, how do we better fight the doctrine in our schools? Because, like, we're already fighting it. Mm-hmm. But, like, are there any more resources that you could recommend, like organizations that tell the truth more other than YAF, obviously?
Yeah. To me, it's a... That's the thing. I was a student at Columbia University for 4 years, and I did realize there's so much I could do as a one person, and eventually I shut down myself. But I think in a way, to me, is it all starts with the self-government, self-responsibility. I think we need to educate ourselves as much as we can first. That's the first step. And don't try to, I think, in a way, changing the world. I didn't begin my activism. I'm gonna go out there giving a lecture to the entire world. I think it just begins with every day we do our best to tell the truth. And I think it's always going back to what Jordan Peterson said to me, you know, make your bed, be kind to people, and tell the truth, and get a job that is helpful, productive in the society, and pray. So I don't think changing the world is that hard thing to do. In a way, anybody can do, even though you're students or not. Yeah. Thank you.
These will be our last two questions.
Oh.
Hello, my name is Kyle Van Meter. Sorry, from Plymouth, Indiana, and thank you for your speech. But I was wondering, what is the official response from, you know, the North Korean government and Kim Jong-un?
Oh, he won't scare me. That's for sure. Official response is they send a lot of assassins to kill defectors like me who speaks out. But I was lucky that I became American citizen last year. Thank you. Yes. So as long as I stay in a country like America or the safe countries, I don't think I will get killed for now. But the official risk is that there is no really response. They really want to go after their enemies. They do not tolerate anybody who dissents. So this thing, something called zero tolerance. That's what North Korean regime does. There's no distance inside North Korea. There's no protest because the regime will not tolerate anything. And that's why they killed 3 generations of my own family, because I spoke out. So, freedom is not free after all. Dozens of my family members too had to die for me to have this voice right now. So I try to not take that for granted and use it honorably. Yeah. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Zeal Marzette. I am from Missouri, but I currently live in Temecula. First of all, I really enjoyed your speech. It was really touching to me. I was wondering, with all the things that are happening in North Korea now, how do you think would be the best way to bring hope to those who are facing what you did?
I've been active in sending, you know, leaflets to North Korea, rescuing North Koreans through the NGOs. But what it comes down to is these problems are so big and a lot of times beyond me. And that brings me down to praying. I think we do have to pray for the North Korean people. I think prayer can go a lot further than we know. And somebody's prayer answered. That's why one pastor came to me to China and saved me. And that's why I'm here. So we never know what our prayer can do. And I hope you can join me to pray for the North Korean people today. So thank you. Yeah. Thank you so much, everyone. Thank you.